Welcome to the 17th meeting in 2023 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I'd like to remind everyone present to please switch their mobile phones to silent. And the first item of business is to decide whether to take items 6, 7 and 8 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private? Okay. Moving to agenda item number 2, we are taking evidence on the Trusts and Succession Scotland Bill. Can I welcome Valerie McNiven, a trustee at the Church of Scotland Trust, Mike Blair, a solicitor and trustee at Gillespie McAndrew, Joan Fraser, the chair of Charitable Trust at Edinburgh and Lothian Trust Fund Skeel, Charlie Marshall, the general manager at Wings for Warriors, Mary Maguire, the director of corporate services at Enable, Chris Sheldon, a trustee at Turk and Connell, Madeline Sproul, a solicitor at the Church of Scotland, who is joining us remotely, and Ian Hood, a trustee of a private trust who is also joining us remotely. Welcome to you all. Can I remind the witnesses to not worry about turning on the microphones during the session, as these are controlled by broadcasting. And if you would like to come in on a question, please raise your hand or indicate to the clerks. And for the witnesses that are online, please type RTS in the chat function, and that there is also no need to answer every question. However, please feel free to follow up in writing to any question after the meeting, if you wish. So with that, we'll move to the questions. So I'm going to open this morning. So first of all, can you provide us with some background to the trust or trusts with which you have a connection and how you become a trustee or a beneficiary, if applicable? For example, what do the trusts that you're involved with aim to do? How many trustees, beneficiaries and potential beneficiaries do they have? So first of all, start with yourself, Chris.
Thanks, Stuart. So my attendance today is in the capacity as a solicitor and also a trustee and a director of trustee companies, both private and family trusts and Scottish charitable trusts. In respect of Scottish charitable trusts, a range of different interests of those particular charities, and got on board through professional engagements through my role as a solicitor and also through personal interests. And in connection with the private and family trusts, those have been in connection with the professional capacity, and the beneficiaries of those trusts vary considerably, can be for specific individuals, named individuals within the trusts, or for a very broad range of beneficiaries, categories of beneficiaries such as direct descendants, some of whom may not even know that they are potential beneficiaries of discretionary trusts. So that's the range of beneficiaries. The trustees usually range between family members or friends of the settlers or trustees or professional contacts, so acting in a professional capacity. And the role of the charity trust, the director of trustee company, is a one which is familiar with many Scottish solicitors who manage and administrate trusts, where rather than having the solicitor appointed in a personal capacity, it is through a corporate trustee arrangement where the directors of the trustee company are all bound, and the trustee company itself is the trustee along with family members.
Okay, thank you. And Mary.
Thank you. So as you said, I'm Director of Corporate Services with Enable, and I'm also in-house counsel there as well. And I primarily came to Enable to work in the trustee service, which is where we look after trusts for beneficiaries who have learning disabilities. You're appointed as effectively the corporate trustee, for want of a better description, in those trusts, and the trusts tend to be established by parents who are looking to provide for some sort of future security for their most likely adult child who has a learning disability. We are also appointed in trusts where awards have been made through the Criminal Injuries Compensation Authority, again for vulnerable beneficiaries who are deemed either by the courts or through prior assessment to that to not have the capacity to manage an award themselves. And we therefore look after those funds in trust on behalf of the beneficiaries. So our beneficiaries tend to be people who have learning disabilities and generally family siblings, sometimes some other family members as well. And the trustees then of those trusts alongside ourselves. There are a few trusts where we act as sole trustee, and there are other trusts where we act alongside parents, grandparents, siblings, aunts, uncles, tends to be family members. And it tends to be family members who are not coming to trusts to work because they have a particular knowledge or a particular wish to do this. In this particular way, it's more about safeguarding a vulnerable family member and looking to provide for them as best they can.
Okay, well, thank you. And Charlie.
Thank you. Charlie Marshall, General Manager and sole employee of the charity Wings for Warriors. We train disabled, physically disabled and medically discharged veterans of all the forces to retrain as airline pilots. The one point which I'm going to bring up at some point is that we are, like a lot of charities, dual registered. We have an OSCA registration and a charities commission number. And I will be interested to know what the opinion is about how this proposal will affect those charities who are also based down in England at the same time, so as to speak.
Okay, no, thank you, Charlie. And Joan.
I'm chair of Edinburgh. I'm here in respect of two trusts, I should say. I'm here because I'm chair of Edinburgh and Lothian Trust Fund. That's a grant-making trust confined, as you might imagine, to Edinburgh and Lothians. We have three funding streams. First of all, there's a general fund, which is the majority of our fundraising. We give out grants to about between 1,000 and 1,200 individuals in poverty in Edinburgh every year. We also operate something called the Edinburgh Fire Fund, which dates back to the Great Fire of Edinburgh in 1824. And it was money that was left over from a public subscription, and we use that to provide grants to householders who've had a house fire, are on a low income and have no contents insurance. And thirdly, we operate something called the Edinburgh Police Fund, which again is another historic fund. 1892, I think, was its origin. And it gives out small grants to families in poverty for school children for the purchase of shoes and jackets. And we also give small grants to local voluntary organisations to help with things like volunteering expenses.
Okay, thank you, John. And
could
Mike.
I just say something Sean? About the other trust, because it's one sure. of the ones that concerns me. So I'm also... a member, I suppose, would be the right, of something called the New Haven Park Trust, which is a trust that was established in 1876 when there was a lot of building going on in the north of Edinburgh, and some of the proprietors got together and said, well, we'd like to keep a bit of green space, and so they bought something which later became New Haven, called New Haven Park. So it's a green space which is preserved for the amenity of the area. And the people who own it, as it were, it's all written into their trust deeds. There's a question mark about whether they're actually trustees or proprietors, but I don't think that really matters. The reason I mention it is because I cannot see in any of the documentation a description of a trust that we would fit with. And so it's very hard to see how the legislation would apply to... I don't think we're... that unusual. I think there are other sort of private gardens and parks in Edinburgh dating from about the same time. I don't know how they're operated. I know Lohman Park is a company, but you know, there's Queen Street Gardens, there's other gardens all around the new town, and I suppose I have a slight concern that perhaps that kind of trust, where it is a trust, is not covered by this legislation.
Okay, thank you for that, John. Mike.
I'm wearing my solicitor's hat. In my time, I have come across trusts impacting on a whole load of stuff, as in commercial partnerships, people who have set up trusts to manage bits of property, inter vivos, as the lawyers say, without anybody having died. What rate is private purposes trusts? I've at least been involved in one of those having to be changed some years ago. Testamentary trusts arising when people have died. Charitable trusts and indeed sort of de facto trusts where people have been left managing money for young children under supervision. So I'm not coming from the point of view of being a trust lawyer. I'm more coming from the point of view of being somebody who's done a fair slice of that, but is a sort of general purpose user of trust law in a variety of fields.
Thank you, Mike. And Valerie.
Thank you. So I'm Valerie McNiven from the Church of Scotland Trust, and I'm a trustee. One of the people online is our secretary, Madeline, from the Law Department. So the Church of Scotland Trust has two areas of function. One is probably of little interest to this committee today, and that's the part that looks after the Church of Scotland's properties out of Scotland, which there is still quite an amount. But the part of interest to the committee is the part that makes us the trustees for a miscellaneous selection of third-party trusts. They're very wide and varied. Some of them go back quite a long time. An example might be locally, where someone had died and left money for the benefit of the particular church in the area where they lived, and the purpose might be further subspecified. Others might be where someone had left money for the provision of education for ministers' children, or for provision of housing for retired ministers and their immediate dependents. So there's a whole range of trusts with various levels of income and capital that supports the income. We, as a group, we meet twice a year, and we endeavour to have a look at all the trusts over the course of a year on a sort of cyclical basis.
Okay, no, thank you. And Ian Hood.
Hello. Yes, I'm Ian Hood, and I am a trustee. Nope, no one's switched me on, I don't think.
Yes, we can hear you, Ian.
Oh, sorry. I'm a trustee for a single adult with a learning disability. I'm currently the only trustee of this trust. I took over in 2016. When the previous trustee retired, and the individual concerned has received a significant amount of money in compensation for a particular issue. And I manage that money in line with the beneficiary, according to their wishes. And it's a discretionary trust. There are some issues in this bill that I'm interested in, particularly I am of concern as I'm the only beneficiary, and therefore what does happen if I become incapable of continuing to manage this and so on. I think some of the provisions in the bill we'll talk about shortly will be of interest, but as I say, I am involved in that way.
Okay, no, thank you, Ian. And Madeline Sproul.
So Valerie has obviously given a very good description of what the Church of Scotland Trust does. I'm a solicitor in the law department in the Church of Scotland, and I'm also secretary of the Church of Scotland Trust. And the only thing I would really add to what Valerie has already said is that because Church of Scotland Trust and the Church of Scotland are registered with OSCAR, all our third-party trusts are charitable trusts.
Okay, well, thank you for that, Madeline. I think Ian's point regarding being the sole trustee, that hasn't come up thus far, certainly in any of the sessions we've had in the committee. So I think that it's the next question I'm going to pose. It probably doesn't include you, Ian, but at the same time, it's actually your situation clearly will not be unique. I'm keen to get your views on this as well. So just in terms of the actual bill itself, do you think the bill has got the balance right between the powers given to trustees directly to act by majority and powers where the court authorises a decision about a trust? And if you would propose any changes to the bill in the area, like what would they be? Can I start with yourself first, Mike.
I reckon that the balance is probably about right from my acquaintance with these trusts. This is not a huge innovation upon quite a lot of what already happens, but it's intended to make it easier. The one thing which did strike me on reading through the papers, and you should maybe ask Chris if I may suggest, knowing when you have recorded that some trustee was not participating or was deemed to be incapable of participation or something like that, for the future record is something which wasn't abundantly clear to me in reading through it.
No, thank you. So, Chris?
I think we probably come on to the aspects of incapacity later, and there's some points probably we, others will maybe have on that. The recording of decision-making, I think, is critical and not necessarily bound within the legislation, but the requirement for access to information is beginning to be built in, and that opens an opportunity for beneficiaries to understand better about aspects of the trust to which they could potentially be entitled. I also agree with Mike in terms of, I think the balance is broadly right. I think there's clearly an extension of the jurisdiction of the courts. I'd probably echo the point in the submission by the Law Society about ensuring that there's sufficient capacity of the courts to manage that. But I would broadly welcome the balance that's being proposed. There are some aspects that are referred to later, I think, on the agenda, which we'll come on to in terms of, for instance, the alteration of trust powers, but nothing specific yet.
OK, no, thank you. Mari?
I think the balance is good. I think the balance has been achieved quite well. What was of particular comfort for me is the trustees that we work with on a day-to-day basis are people who often themselves are in receipt of means-tested state benefits. So to put in place a process that would require multiple times and rounds of visiting court processes, legal fees, etc., that couldn't all necessarily be borne from the trust's own funds, would put significant burden on those people. So I think there's a good balance. There's the ability for people to go on and do what they need to do, continue to run the trust, and whenever there's significant issues or difficulties, then there's a process there for them to rely upon.
OK, no, thank you. Ian Hood.
Yes. What I would add to what I said earlier is that when I took over in 2016, there were two trustees. One of the trustees resigned last year, and we had a look at that time for a replacement trustee, and it turned out to be quite difficult to identify somebody who would be willing to do this. And that remains an issue that I haven't been able to find a satisfactory solution for just yet, which, you know, trustees have a lot of power, you know, and I think that the guidance that's put forward is important, but I simply hold my hands up at this point to say that there is a concern about what happens. I am 2 months younger than the person that I'm trust for, so we're in a kind of an arms race as to see who will either spend the money first or whether I'll continue to be able to function as a trustee. These are an important issue, but I'm not completely sure that the bill will help resolve that. But I do wonder whether or not there is an issue about the court being able to appoint for the trustees to help manage out in these situations. I'm sure I can't be the only one in this position, because most trusts happen under the wire. They're not necessarily registered anywhere. So.
OK, no, thank you. Madeline.
I would agree that the balance seems to be good, and we welcome the fact that trustees now have default powers, but you don't have to refer to the 1921 Act to check on. And equally, it's good to know that the court can step in where required. I would agree with Ian Hood's point, though, and this was something that came up in the Charities Bill, where OSCR are being given powers to appoint trustees, that in general it can be difficult to identify appropriate trustees, and perhaps some more clarity around how court would be able to identify these trustees would be useful.
Okay, thank you, Madeline. Would anyone else want to come in on this? Yes, Joan.
If we're talking about the balance of powers and so on, I mean, I think that seems about right to me. The one thing that does concern me is section 12.1, which says a decision binds the trustees only if made by a majority of those for the time being able to make it. And to me, a simple majority for any, it doesn't seem to specify what kind of decision, but it could be something very fundamental. In other circumstances, in charity and in corporate law, you need a significant majority, a 2/3, 3/4 majority for something that's very significant. So I think that that is probably an area that could be strengthened, that you could say something about, you know, but where needs to define what sort of decision would be regarded as significant enough to require more than a simple majority. But I think that would be a valuable addition.
Okay. So Mike was...
I was expressing skepticism, I'm afraid. Almost all the trusts that I've come across proceed on the basis of simple majority, and they've got odd numbers of trustees who flew in and out from time to time, and the extra effort involved in trying to work out what majorities might be would strike me as superfluous, that most of this ought to be covered by the fiduciary duty and the ability of beneficiaries to complain and kick people in the shins if it's not done right. And I understand where you're coming from, but I'm not sure it's as major an issue as that.
Well, it is the arrangement that applies to charitable trusts.
Fine.
And that's required by OSCAR. They require a significant, usually two-thirds or three-quarters majority. For things like changing your purposes or your constitution, a kind of major decision that affects the nature of the trust quite significantly.
Okay. Well, thank you. Yes, Chris.
Just a point which Ian raised in terms of the burden on trustees, or the perceived burden on trustees or potential trustees, both in private or family trusts and charitable trusts. And I think when the Charities Act came into being, there was a concern that charity trustees might not step forward, but it hasn't actually borne out. But it is an onerous task and responsibility, and I think there needs to be careful management of that, particularly where there is potential disincentive in this bill, where a potential exposure to trustees' personal patrimony in the event of, I think it's unnecessary litigation, and how that is managed in terms of the messaging to prevent potential trustees from stepping forward to take on the responsibility for fear of personal exposure to risk.
Okay, thank you. Would anyone else like to come in on this question? No? Okay, thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Yep, thanks very much. Now, incapable trustees, and on the 9th of May we had a session here where legal academics appeared before the committee and offered a more relaxed view of than some other legal stakeholders on whether there were risks associated with sections 7 and 12 of the bill for incapable adults. Now, so therefore, can I just ask, for those of you who are trustees, would you feel confident in your ability as a trustee in that role to assess whether a fellow trustee is incapable as required, for example, in these sections 7 and 12 of the bill? Would you like input from a doctor, psychologist, mental health officer? Would that be helpful? And should this formally be written into the bill? Can I ask anybody if they've got any points on that?
Happy to start. Yes, this is actually a situation that we've come across ourselves, where we were asked to make that decision. And, you know, having no knowledge of the individual personally, having no input in someone's life beyond several times a year having a discussion about releasing funds to another person, we didn't find ourselves in a position where we could make that assessment, and we asked for medical support in order to make the decision. And I think that would be useful. And I say that as a practicing solicitor, as someone working, you know, across trusts on a, you know, on an ongoing basis, we didn't feel that any myself or my colleague had the ability to make that decision. And so, if, you know, Ian, without putting words in your mouth, I'm not sure if you would necessarily feel, you know, as an individual trustee, that you had the, you know, the knowledge of the situation to make that decision. I think something more prescriptive in the legislation would be useful.
Thanks. Can I just ask, Mary, on the back of that, if you don't mind, how legally did you handle that? Did you feel confident in doing that, and were you supported legally in doing that?
Yes, we had another trustee, so there was ourselves at Enable and two family member trustees. They weren't husband and wife, they weren't brother and sister, but they were in-laws. And so the other trustee had also raised concerns, and we shared those concerns, and it was resolved through the family route, where they supported their family member to effectively meet with their GP, and we had an assessment of capacity undertaken.
Okay, well, that's very, very helpful. And can I just, well, and anyone else as well who might have something to say about this, and on this matter, If it was written into the bill that doctor, psychologist, mental health officer would be the right route to go, should it be formally written into the bill? And if not, what other kind of support or further support or input would you want a trustee to have in making decisions such as this? I mean, if hearing what Mary said, it doesn't necessarily have to have anything further written, does it? No.
I think what might be useful is to cross-reference the Adults with Incapacity Act. Ah. And so if there's any, you know, any situation where you are uncertain about the level of capacity or whether the co-trustee has sufficient capacity, then to follow the routes outlined within the Adults with Incapacity Act would tie the two together.
Thank you.
Yeah, Charlie?
Sorry if I... Thank you. I didn't quite hear that, but I get... I fully understand the system about having or having trustees who suffer from mental health issues, that there should be the power available to have them removed if their actions are contrary to the aims and objectives of the charity. But how does one enforce that?
Mike, can I just come back to what I said a minute ago about the difficulty of recording this? If you're a body of trustees or a solicitor advising a body of trustees and they want to argue that two of the people are too decrepit to sensibly contribute what's going on, and you've got two other trustees who are the active ones, how does that get recorded? Now, if you were the solicitor, you would look for something from some external source if there's any doubt about it. But equally, we're accustomed to a situation where you're dealing with, for example, powers of attorney, where people get old, become unable, the family recognise that's the case, and no particular formality is required to bring the power of attorney into use to allow somebody to act on the person's behalf. But there is a grey area in there which I think professional practice would need to record as to what it was the prudent thing to do to make sure you were right in making use of these powers to disregard particular persons' contributions to a trust, although they might still be on the list of trustees.
Thanks very much for that, Mike. On the back of what Mary was saying there, of course, she's legal background and so on, but maybe some trusts might not have people in that same position. And do you think, therefore, that it could be written into the bill about access to doctor, psychologist and mental health officer could be a good thing to go ahead with? Just in order to give confidence to those people who were in those positions. Anybody?
It's a difficult area. Potentially asking lay trustees to assess incapacity, mm-hmm. and it's a subjective test, and it's a difficult test to assess. And the extent to which evidence or vouching or justification of that assessment and then the recording of that, both for the trustees or trustee making the decision and also for the alleged incapable trustee, and to what extent they have a right to challenge that, and to what extent they would have any awareness of the fact that there is a move to remove them on grounds of a subjective test of incapacity. And in the event of there being two trustees, but one trustee is absent, I think there could be risk, and safeguarding would need to be considered as to how that action could be enabled, that the present trustee takes a view for vexatious or other personal interests to determine that their co-trustee is incapable and then undertakes actions, selling a property, selling investments, taking action to distribute the fund without the awareness of their co-trustee. Or the ability for that co-trustee to then raise a course action to challenge, which could effectively seek to try and undo any actions undertaken by the trustee. So there's a number of aspects, notwithstanding the point made by Mary about the link with the Adults with Incapacity Act test of incapacity. So a number of areas. I'm not sure whether the right answer is to bind into legislation an obligation to seek a medical certificate, but I think some area an area needs further thought on exactly how to manage that so as to protect both the trustees trying to reach the decision and also the trustee who's affected by it.
Thank you very much. I think that was really helpful, actually, to get a range of experience and options that might be able to be figured on. That was good.
So I'll go back to Charlie, because obviously, Charlie, when you posed that question a moment ago...
I'm sorry?
When you posed the question a moment ago, do you have any thoughts on Bill's question?
If this is written in that a trustee who is under, shall we say, suspicion of acting in a way not commensurate with the aims and objectives of the charity, how would he or she be compelled to undertake a medical examination? And what form of medical examination should it take? I mean, there's a world of difference between a GP, a psychiatrist, and a psychologist. They all have different skill sets. And I think a question has to be asked as to who is going to enforce it, who's going to decide what form of assessment that trustee is going to go through. And does the trustee have the right of appeal? And if so, how will that appeal be carried out?
Okay. I think it's fair to say, that hasn't come up, certainly in the evidence over the last couple of weeks either, so that's actually very useful. Sorry. Valerie?
I was just going to raise a broader question about process, which is in relation to time that all this might take, and what would happen if decisions were needed, especially with a particularly small trust, during the time when there was doubt about the capacity of one or more of the trustees. It begins to get a bit technical to specify this in the bill itself, but I just wonder whether there ought to be some provision for some backup regulations as to the process here.
Okay. No, thank you. Sorry, just before I bring you in, Joan, just to let you know, this is Andy. Andy's a parliament photographer. I'll sit and take some photos of the committee taking place today. Okay. Joan.
What some other people have said. I mean, Section 7 says a trustee who is, and there are three subsections which are provable facts, you know, convictions and so on. A trustee who is incapable, who makes that decision? And I think it would have to be deemed incapable, because the trustees can't make a decision about whether somebody's incapable. I haven't ever been involved in a sort of family trust, but I've been on lots of boards where there have been trustees who, you know, have been there for a very long time, maybe very committed to the charity, but can't actually fulfil the charitable role. And usually it's a question of kind of gradually and gently easing them out, but that might not always be possible. So I think there does need to be a bit of process around a trustee who is deemed incapable. I don't think you can say that they are incapable. I think there needs to be some sort of assessment of it so that it's evidenced in some way.
So just on that, do you think also what Mary suggested regarding the cross-referencing to the Adults with Incapacity Act, do you think that would be useful as well?
I'm not really familiar with that legislation, so I would take Mary's word for it. She's more expert than I, but that might be one way of doing it. It might also be worth looking at what happens with charity law and trustees with incapacity.
Okay, thank you. Mary, you wanted to...
Thank you. I just wanted to follow up on Valerie's point about what do you do in the interim if one or more trustee is potentially, you know, under suspicion or investigation for being incapable. And this, I think, and I will need to check, I hadn't actually prepared this coming into today, so I will check and follow back up. In a number of the trusts where Enable is appointed as a trustee, we're appointed with trustee sine qua non powers, which effectively makes us the lead trustee. So it means that if mum and dad are on holiday and in, I don't know, some remote part of Timbuktu with no access to internet or telephone signal, we can make a decision if we need to, because we have a lead trustee power. So it's effectively the chair's casting vote in a meeting, but we have that. We don't use it unless we absolutely have to, so we confirm that with families whenever the trusts are set up. But in a case of last resort in dire straits, we will make a decision on our own if we have to, and we will then justify it to the other trustees and explain why. So I don't know if there's maybe scope, and it would probably be in an explanatory note or guidance rather than in the legislation, but there are ways to create a lead trustee or to give some sort of power so that in that hiatus you're still able to make decisions and the beneficiary isn't left wanting for any reason. It might be something that we could consider somewhere, and I will find the background to it for where it originated from, but effectively a trustee with lead powers may be able to fill the gap.
Okay, thank you. That's it, Mike, and then Chris, and then we'll move on.
All on the same theme, you also get situations, of course, where the trustees, there's dissension amongst the trustees as to what they ought to do for whatever reason. And obviously you can have trustees of different ages, and if you've got four trustees, two of whom think one of the two dissenters is not very able and therefore should be disregarded, you get yourself into a stramash. And I suspect that the bottom line with all of these things is that you would need to go to court. But there's a spectrum of this between somebody who is clearly no longer able, which most people would be happy to accept along the same lines as people can't do a power of attorney, and people who you might not think they were thinking straight, but they do, and how you actually, you know, there does not exist a measuring stick for this. And because there's not a measuring stick, the point that you were making about, how do we resolve this and how long does it take, is occasionally going to be an issue, I think.
OK. Well, thank you, Mike. And Chris.
Just a pointer on Mary's comments. I don't think that sine qua non trustees are referred to in any aspects in connection with the bill, and whether that has any consideration or consequence. But going back to the definition of incapable under Section 75, which is almost exact to the adults with incapacity, but I think there is some nuance and difference. I think the concern which I've heard and spoken with others about is the potential for definition drift between the two acts over time, and awareness for individuals trying to interpret, and under the Adults with Incapacity Act seems the most appropriate place for the review of that assessment. And recognising that with capacity law reform and the Scottish Mental Health Law Review, the most appropriate place is probably with that side, rather than have a separate, distinct definition which may be stagnant under the Trust Bill.
OK, no, thank you. Jeremy.
Chris, can I just absolutely nail this one on that? So your view on this would be not to have a definition within this bill, but simply refer to back to the adults with incapacity, so that if that definition changes at any point, you wouldn't have to then reopen this Act, you would just refer back to any... Is that right?
That's right, yeah.
OK, that's helpful, thank you.
OK. Jeremy. Sorry. I think that Ian, I want to come in just on this point, and then what about you? Ian? You're on mute, Ian.
Are we back?
Yes, that's you.
Yeah. So just on this point, I was going to raise it later on the powers of the court, but I still would prefer mediation, having only been involved in a small trust, the small number of trustees in which the trustee resigned because she felt she was incapable of continuing due to personal health reasons, meant that, you know, for me, mediation or other ways of resolving this without getting into a kind of tight legal battle that swallows up trust resources would be some way of doing that. And I'd felt that, I don't know whether such things as ACAS or some other mediation service would be a way of resolving this rather than trying to get into some kind of, as somebody mentioned, a kind of compulsory inspection of somebody's capability, which will just lead to, I think, quite a difficult situation. And obviously, you have to cover these grounds within legislation, but I didn't really feel there was perhaps enough about mediation in the legislation as it stood, and this is one of the issues which could be resolved quite easily, or in many situations, with the chat.
OK. No, thank you for that, Ian. And Jeremy.
Thank you, Gavina, and can I welcome the panel. Can I also just for the Wednesday night to declare that I am a member of the Church of Scotland, but have no financial interest. The bill has new powers for the Sheriff Court, but the predominant power still remains with the Court of Session. I'm just wondering what are the pros and cons for that? And it was suggested to us in previous evidence that the trustees should be able to decide whether they go to the Sheriff Court or the Court of Session rather than it being prescribed. I'm just wondering if anyone has a view on that.
Okay, yes, Valerie?
Well, I think one would have to at least think on the question of costs, but I've not been able to just do a check on the relative costs of raising the action of going to the one court or the other. But I think if there was an ability of the court that could do it more efficiently and more economically, then ask the committee at least to have a look at that.
Thank you. Mike?
I've been involved in Court of Session applications to change trusts, and you're dealing by and large with the judges there who, many of them have probably more acquaintance with this kind of stuff, or there are people amongst them who do. Local sheriffs don't always. In fact, it's probably commonplace for sheriffs not to be hugely conversant with this branch of the law because it's not the kind of stuff that comes up. The point of cost is spot on, of course. The simpler this can be done, the easier. But in the nature of what you're talking about here, where there's an element of contention, which is what led to it in the first place, it's difficult to get past that. The other problem with mediation, just to mention, is it's a fine thing if you can do it, and I've been involved in several, but it requires both or all parties to play along, and that's why courts are the sort of bottom line. If you can't get people to play along, which they are open to do just now, then you need a backstop.
Okay, thank you. Anyone online? Madeline, Ian? No, okay. Chris?
I would support Valerie and Mike's points there, striking the right balance between having the right expertise in court, but moderated against the cost is a difficult one to strike. I think it's probably struck right in the balance between Sheriff Court and Court of Session in the bill, but there'll be circumstances where it's not right for particular matters.
Okay. Thank you. Jeremy?
Thank you. That's helpful. We've obviously just touched on this, and Mike's just touched on it again, but we have had evidence in the previous couple of sessions in regard to resolving disputes through mediation or arbitration. Obviously, as we've already heard from Mike, this has to be if everyone's willing to do it. In principle, should it be in the bill, or should it simply be something that might be within a kind of encouragement in guidance?
I'm not quite sure of the answer to that. I would like to see it encouraged, but I'm not sure necessarily of the consequences of enforcing it and getting the ability to compel people to engage in it, and to what extent you need to go down that route to enable that or to have to get through that as a barrier in order to then enable you to access court. So, for instance, if there had to be a process of mediation or arbitration prior to court, could that be a barrier to efficiency and speed and actually enabling actions of the trustees which could otherwise be hindered by having to go through an obligatory process?
Okay. Madeline?
The question there?
No, breaking back in, Jeremy.
I didn't hear what she said, sorry, apologies.
Sorry, I missed the question.
Yes. It was just following up on what we've just been talking about, of whether it should be in the bill formally that mediation or arbitration should take place before any court action is considered, whether that should be in the bill itself or whether it should maybe be more in the guidance given around a good practice.
Okay. I think I'd agree with the previous speaker. It would be very difficult to compel people to engage in mediation. And therefore, if you make it prescriptive in the bill, it could lead to delays in actually getting the decisions made.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you. And Ian Hood.
Yeah, I mean, I do think mediation should be in the bill. I'd be happy for it being put in as one of the suggestions, not necessarily as preliminary to court action, but one of the options that trustees can choose to resolve disputes, whether it's about trustees or about any other decisions that they take. I have to confess to having never been to a court in my life. I know we have many lawyers present who I'm sure could help, but the reality is that for many trustees, these are areas that we wouldn't normally go into. I suspect that actually having some more low-level, informal way of resolving things should be included within the bill to allow people to be able to choose a route that can resolve these things easily without getting tied up in court action.
Okay, thank you. Mike Blair.
Just in practice, most of these things get argued out amongst trustees, be they charitable, testamentary, with family issues or whatever, and decisions are come to. As the law now stands, there's nothing to stop people taking that to mediation if they were so minded. And I agree with the point of view that there's no point making it compulsory. It just adds a stage to things, doesn't add hugely to the purpose. It's open there if people need it, but we do need a backstop.
OK, thank you. Valerie, Charlie and Chris.
I think Mike's kind of led into the point I was going to make, but I think we've got to be careful if we're dealing here with making public law, that we understand the difference between an informal way of settling a dispute and actually mediation, which has got certain technicalities about it. And I think if we were to start specifying mediation in the bill, then you would be really needing to have some cross-reference to what that really meant. And, we've talked about some of the elements of it. There needs to be an agreement of both parties, but there also needs to be a mediator. And where's that person going to come from? And, what are the qualifications and appropriateness of that person to deal with the situation?
OK, no, thank you. Charlie?
I think mediations and medicals are all very well, but they do take a lot of time and, in many cases, money to resolve. I think some of these problems could be stopped by having a fixed tenure for all trustees. Say that it had to be redone every AGM. It would mean that you could get rid of a troublesome trustee at the maximum of a year with no external influence or bills.
OK, no, thank you. And Chris.
It was just to reflect on the previous points, and not necessarily always for disputes, but to recognise the opportunity to petition the court for direction, which isn't in the bill present, but the opportunity to ask questions, to seek direction, I think is a useful mechanism that could be afforded to trustees. The point about mediation or arbitration, I think, is the same type of encouragement that trustees ought to know and when to take advice, professional or otherwise. And not something necessarily be bound into legislation, but to be encouraged as part of recognising trustees' duties.
OK, thank you. And back to Jeremy. I think you'd have another question?
Mercedes.
Right, OK. Right, Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to move us on to Section 16 and 17 of the Bill, which relate to the trustees' powers of investment. So the committee's had a suggestion from the Law Society and from the academic Yvonne Evans that in view of Scotland's increasing emphasis on net zero goals, that Section 16 and 17 should be amended to explicitly allow trusts to adopt environmentally friendly investment policies, particularly when these might underperform compared to other investments. So we're really interested to hear from everyone today on that proposal, whether you think an amendment to the bill would help reassure trustees that that kind of investment is allowed, or whether you think the current wording is satisfactory, and any experience that you've had in relation to investment decisions would be helpful to hear as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Who'd like to start? Okay, Chris.
Was attending a webinar recently and looking at the English law position and the Butler's loss against the Charity Commission, which has clarified this area of law in England, and the recognition of the evolution and development of impactful acting and purposeful acting of trustees, whether for a private or family or for a charity, and recognising not only the principal action of investing for growth or for yield to maximise the finances of the trust, but also to recognise the purpose of the trust, whether that is a family or a charity. So I think it is a useful addition that Yvonne has put forward in terms of clarifying, not necessarily just for environmental, but social, governance or purposeful principles. Recognise that there may be a price for those principles in terms of investment or financial gain, but recognising in some particular trust that will be appropriate for the nature of the beneficiaries or because of the settlers and their particular wishes.
Thank you. And Mike?
It goes back to the purpose of the trust, I suspect. If the purpose of the trust is focused in that direction, then deciding to put the trust's resources in something which pushes it along is fine. If, on the other hand, it's money which you've been told to look after by granddad for the grandchildren without any particular specification, you're at least at some risk of the trustees second-guessing what's good for the country at large versus the people who might be getting the money later in the day. And it's not an easy thing to say, unless there's some sort of warrant for it in the way in which the trust has been set up in the first place, or has indeed been modified over time to set it up in the first place. There's nothing to stop people doing it just now, but there's a balance to be struck as to what are we trying to achieve? What is the aim?
Okay, thank you. Charlie and then Valerie.
Very briefly, I don't think we should be in the position of trying to tell trustees what they should or should not invest in. Their primary responsibility is to get as much as they can for the charity, regardless of what might or might not be perceived to be the common weal.
Okay, thank you. And Valerie.
Yeah, well, I suspect that the Church of Scotland meeting in General Assembly this week will from time to time touch on this issue, and I think probably relevant to think that the debate there is likely to be very wide, and so I think here what's important is that you've got flexibility and breadth in the powers without being too specific. It seems to me that the wording of the section there, section 17, is at the moment pretty broad, and perhaps to try and tie it down will just lead to further difficulties on how far you go.
Okay, thank you. Joan.
My area of knowledge is largely in relation to charitable trusts, where OSCAR, the charity regulator, has issued guidance to charitable trusts about investment and balancing the aim of trying to maximise your income so that you can maximise your grant making in accordance with your trust, your purposes, but balancing that against ethical, social and governance concerns. And most charitable trusts nowadays have an ethical investment policy or an ESG policy, so that could be something. It's not the case that the duty of a trustee is, certainly in charitable trusts, is to maximise the gain. They've got to balance against that what are your charitable purposes. So, for example, in Edinburgh Lothian Trust Fund, because our business is all about helping people in poverty, we don't invest in alcohol, tobacco and various other things, gambling, which are areas of harm, in particular for people in poverty. So I don't see that there's a difficulty in saying that trustees of any kind should balance the objectives of the trust against the ethical dimension to investing.
Okay, thank you. Chris, you want back in?
It was just to follow up on that point there, where the trustees might feel exposed, where they take a particular view, but because of that view taken for the social purpose, that there's an underperformance or even a loss as a result of their actions. And that's where I think there needs to be afforded some protection to the trustees in connection with that slight clarification of the bill provision to empower the trustees to be able to make such impact or social or ESG type investments, knowing that they wouldn't be vulnerable to claim or challenge in the event that such investment policy was underperforming or even incurring a loss for the basis of making those impactful decisions.
Okay, thank you. Anyone online? Ian or Madeline? Madeline?
Yeah, just to agree with the points that have already been made, I think it's difficult to make a positive direction in the bill in this way, but anything which can clarify that trustees will not be penalised for having such an investment strategy would be a good thing to protect trustees' interests.
Okay, thank you. So we'll move on to Oliver.
Hi, thank you, Convener. I was interested in sections 25 and 26 of the bill. There's been some concern expressed to the committee about trustees' duties to provide information to beneficiaries and potential beneficiaries under these sections, specifically that they're too onerous and that the extent of the duties are uncertain. I'd be interested if you wanted to share your views on these proposals, particularly if you have concerns, and I'd be interested in how you would change sections 25 and 26 of the bill to address those concerns. Is there anyone?
Thank you. Who would like to start? Mike.
Did I move my head by mistake? But no, one comes across this occasionally where you've got different attitudes between trustees and potential beneficiaries. Solicitors on the board who are involved in private practice will have occasionally come across this, I suppose, where you hear of people not letting on just exactly what the trust says or does, or refusing to provide information for beneficiaries, or indeed potential beneficiaries. Sometimes that's just frownness or dissent on the part of the particular trustees, who don't think it's any particular business of people whom they view as being remote connections to the trust to be provided with information. But equally, there can be other situations where it is proper that people should know what's going on. Testamentary trust, for example, when somebody dies and money has to be managed for some years, perhaps until children grow up. If there's not reasonable clarity as to what's going on, then people are clearly going to be disadvantaged because they're entitled to conduct their affairs in the knowledge of where they stand. I have no magic test to say when you've got to disclose stuff and when not, but the difficulties tend to arise when people trying to keep it too close to their chest, as I have often thought in practice, unnecessarily, but that's in the eye of the beholder.
Okay, thank you. Mari.
This is probably quite a specific example, but it might give some context of why I think it should be a trustee duty to provide information on request. So you take the example of a discretionary trust that only has one sole beneficiary. So without the class of beneficiaries, you have an absolute beneficiary who is also in receipt of means-tested state benefits and has a duty to provide information on their entire estate to HMRC in assessment of their benefits or to local authority at whatever point they need the information. To withhold the information from HMRC or the local authority when going through that assessment for state benefits will ultimately prejudice the individual. And if they don't have the information from the trustees to be able to provide in with the trustees and the knowledge that that person is the absolute beneficiary, there is no other beneficiary potentially to that trust, then not having that information ultimately hurts the beneficiary of the trust. who, in the sorts of discretionary trusts that, that Enable works with, that's the ultimate goal, is to protect the beneficiary, not to not to cause them financial harm or hardship by withholding information.
Okay, no, thank you. Valerie.
I don't think I've got very much to contribute on this one, because, well, one point I would make is that in relation to the trusts that Church of Scotland Trust concerned with, the actual beneficiaries at the end of the day are really often so broad that we wouldn't really know who they were. The sort of examples I gave in my introduction about perhaps children of clergy or in relation to housing. So I think we just have to be careful that we haven't specified in a way that one could have a challenge from somebody that we didn't think was a beneficiary, but they became aware and thought perhaps they were missing out on something. So I don't think I've got really much to say on the provisions themselves.
Okay, no, thank you. So just certainly from a beneficiary's perspective, can I ask Charlie for your view on how easy it is to actually access information about trusts that you have an interest in?
I'm sorry, I missed the question.
Sure. So from a beneficiary's perspective, can I ask you for your view on how easy it is to access information about trusts that you may have an interest in?
I'm not going to comment any further on that one, if you don't mind.
No bother. Okay, thank you. Yeah. Oliver? Sorry, Chris.
It was just the opposite effect of Mary's comment, where you have a trust with a very broad range of potential beneficiaries, and understanding the scope of likelihood of a potential beneficiary and how that is borne out, and what actions trustees might then take to then exclude individuals who are seeking to find information about a trust in which it's unlikely that they would ever receive a beneficial interest, and to understand how that might be monitored. But otherwise, I didn't have any other comments that have already been made in previous submissions, particularly through the Law Society.
Okay, thank you. Oliver?
Yeah, so I was going to move on to section 61 of the bill, which gives a power to the beneficiaries and others to apply to the court to alter the trust purpose of a family trust where there's been a material change in circumstances. Section 61 sets out the default position that this power cannot be used for 25 years. I'd be interested to know, and as a committee, would be interested to know if you think this is the correct approach, having this 25-year restriction, and to understand your reasoning.
Okay. Who would like to start? Mary.
So I used to work with the family trusts, but that was about 15 years ago. So I sort of trust I tend to work in are slightly different now. But with the trusts that we work with, and the beneficiaries and the families we work with, there are people in and around the trusts, trustees and beneficiaries who are living with relatively tight constraints. And I think 25 years for that group of people would be quite difficult to deal with. If there's money in the trust, it has very, very bespoke and very, very restricted purposes, and the family falls on hardship more widely and are unable to access that money beyond very specific purposes for 25 years would be quite, I think, challenging. But obviously there are trusts at the other end of the spectrum that wouldn't be an issue for.
Okay, thank you. Ian or Madeline online? Madeline?
It's not really an area that I work in at all, because it obviously only relates to private trusts, but I would agree with what Mary has said, that 25 years could be too long for certain groups of beneficiaries.
Okay, thank you. Mike Blair?
I've been involved in varying trusts, usually to get out of a thing which had not thought to be a problem in 1980, but was going to be a problem in 2020, and I suspect, Chris, you've seen similar sort of stuff. This is a bit of a new exploration of changing around private trusts like this, and I don't claim to have read, I haven't read fully into the report by the Law Commission on the subject, but the idea that you do need to change them from time to time and to redirect what's happening seems to me to be very necessary. I suppose you could make it that normally 25 years on special cause shown, you could go to the court or something like that. But The idea, I suppose, is that people can't just constantly mess around with something that was set up by the guy who set it up in the first place just because they changed their mind in 5, 10 or 12 years' time.
OK, thank you. I'll go to Chris and then to Ian.
I agree with Mike's point there. I think the bar should be set appropriately high to override the wishes of the settlor in determining the trust purposes and the trust arrangements. I'm not sure whether the time limit is necessarily the right factor for that, and so I'd perhaps see not necessarily as entirely appropriate that 25-year period, or whether there ought to be a period at all. I understand it is one potential measure in putting in place a high bar, potentially as a generational move. Evolution or development of the trust and circumstances have changed over that period of time, but I'm not entirely convinced by the setting of a provision of time, particularly at as long as 25 years, which does seem too long.
Well, just on that then, if it's not this as a mechanism, what would you like to see?
So if it is on the grounds of circumstantial change, I would expect to see it as substantial shift, deviation from the settler's wishes and the extent of which the provision of trust has been put in place in the first place, and to set out a case as to why it is appropriate that, in the similar way that you petition the Court of Session as to why a variation is justified and rationalised, why it should be accepted, petition put forward as to what are the substantial changes and to what extent it doesn't disbenefit the individuals and why it's necessary, not necessarily set out as a you have to get beyond a 25-year period before that opportunity presents itself.
Okay, well, thank you. Now, Ian.
Yeah, I mean, in the case of the trust that I'm involved with, the settlor is actually the beneficiary who, when he received this compensation, decided to place this in a trust to help him manage this money. Now, in that situation, and I'm sure not all settlers are deceased and may have a continuing viewpoint, and while the trust is set up, there may be a point that I see comes in the future when the current beneficiary may choose to seek an amendment in the trust, and I think there should be an option for that. 25 years from when the trust was set up, actually it's not that far from now, but 25 years from now might be far too long. So, I mean, I do think an earlier date as an option would be helpful in some situations.
OK, no, thank you. Oliver?
I guess it touches kind of on that point, but a bit more broad. We heard on the 9th of May from Yvonne Evans, and I think Professor Gretton agreed, legal academic, that in practice a solicitor would just draft around a 25-year provision. Maybe for Chris and Mike, but do you think we're worrying probably too much about this, and that most trusts would be drafted to give some leeway in terms of purpose?
I'm not sure that would be a helpful consequence, that trusters or settlers then needed to reflect on the fact that they couldn't anticipate future change and evolution of circumstances, because they're anticipating, if they are at a particular stage in their life, the trust to exist beyond them, and an inability of the trustees to adjust because circumstances have changed. Some settlers would not wish any circumstantial change to affect the trust terms. But I think looking to modernise, and this bill does that, I think you'd want to be a situation where a settler could be aware of the fact that this provision existed, but if there wasn't awareness that it was a 25-year period, I think you might then see a drafting around and therefore a broadening of trust purposes, which is not necessarily what the settler wants to put in place, because they're being forced to make something much more broad range than they anticipate. For instance, if there are no further family beneficiaries, direct descendants, because they pass away, then it might be conceived that the settler would wish to see charities benefit. And so if there's not, for instance, a power to add beneficiaries of a charitable nature, then the trust might trustees might seek a petition to include charitable beneficiaries, but it wouldn't otherwise be the mind of the settler to include charitable beneficiaries from the instance, because of the fact it's a trust designed to be for family members or direct descendants. So I think it would see an unnecessary broadening of trust purposes from the outset if there was a barrier of a 25-year period. So potentially, yes, there would be, but I'm not sure necessarily for a positive consequence.
Okay.
Mike?
No, I had nothing to add from what Chris has said. Thank you.
Okay. No, thank you.
Okay. Would anyone else want to come in just before we move on? No? Okay, thank you. And Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to move us on to section 65 and 66 in the bill, which relates to expenses of litigation. The committee's heard from the Law Society and some other legal stakeholders who are concerned about the current policy underpinning section 65, which provides principles to determine how legal bills are paid for in trust cases. Specifically, it provides that trustees will be personally liable for these expenses in certain situations, including when the trust fund doesn't have enough resources to cover them. So the Law Society thinks that this section 65 will deter people from becoming trustees and may lead trustees to unfavourably settle or abandon legal proceedings for fear of personal liability. So we're keen to hear whether you share these concerns or whether you can offer us any reassurance. And a sort of follow-up question would be whether you think the availability of insurance helps mitigate the risks identified by the Law Society.
Okay. Valerie.
Thank you. Well, I think you've stated it pretty clearly that this, we've heard already that it's not always easy to find trustees, and anything that's seen as a disincentive would clearly make matters worse. So I think there is a real issue here. I think the question of insurance is covered elsewhere in the bill, and I think that in principle it's a mitigation for trustees. However, I've been involved in another trust where we have actually got insurance, although our risks are very low. But I think I've heard elsewhere that it's not always easy to find such insurance, so one has to kind of be balanced on the other. I think there is a risk to disincentivise trustees. I think that could be mitigated by insurance if you could find the right policy.
Thank you.
Okay, so Mike, Gillespie McAndrew had said it was dangerous to rely on insurance.
I think I subscribe to that because, as you were saying, getting a hold of insurance, I mean, this is insurance against, it can't be an insurance against you doing something daft as a trustee because you shouldn't be doing it in the first place. This is insurance against some daft claim against you. Well, that's probably much more desirable, and indeed that's what a lot of domestic insurance contains. I've no direct experience with going around looking for such insurance, I should say. The business about trustees' personal liability has got to be true. The question, I suppose, is if it's the trustees who are engaging in some dispute which they sensibly ought not to do, then why shouldn't they be personally sticking their necks out? If, on the other hand, it's something that's come to them, that's a different situation entirely. And it puts them in an invidious position of having to either roll over because they haven't got the resources to defend it or stick their neck out.
Okay. Thank you. Madeline.
From a sort of practical point of view, that I was asked to look into obtaining trustee indemnity insurance for the Church of Scotland Trust, and the Church of Scotland has its own insurance services company, and they have been unable to source appropriate trustee indemnity insurance both for the Church of Scotland Trust and for the Housing and Loan Fund trustees. Just something to bear in mind that whilst it would mitigate some of the provisions in the bill, it's not altogether easy to find.
Okay, thank you. And John.
I think I would agree. It's not easy to find, but there are one or two companies that do trustee indemnity insurance. So maybe there are differences with the Church of Scotland that makes these policies not appropriate for you. But we certainly have, at the Edinburgh Lothian Trust Fund, we have trustee indemnity insurance. Although, I mean, Mike's absolutely right. It doesn't insure you against failing to exercise your duties properly. You know, if you act unlawfully, then the policy is null and void. But if you, through no fault of your own, end up on the wrong end of some sort of lawsuit, then the indemnity insurance will cover you.
Thank you. Mary.
I think this is one of these things where you see the sort of dichotomy between professional trustees and personal trustees. So we obviously have various business insurances which cover off liabilities for certain things. Individuals potentially don't have the means or the ability to source the insurance. And so I think if there was some sort of, I don't know quite how it would slot in, but you know, the insurance premiums, for example, could possibly be borne out of trust estates. But beyond that, if there is some sort of funding available, whether it's legal aid funding, for example, but some sort of eligibility towards contribution of costs. Because I think back to the point that Ian had made earlier on, this is something that would ultimately put people off from being trustees. And with a dearth of volunteers coming forward in some areas, I think it would be quite a significant barrier to know that even if you have insurance, it doesn't necessarily protect against all of your actions, and you're effectively personally liable for certain things simply because you've come forward to help other people.
Thank you. Chris?
I'd agree with that. It could be an unwelcome headline to on which a disincentive for potential volunteers as trustees, in most cases an unpaid office, it's responsible, and as I mentioned at the outset, it's a high and onerous obligation to undertake the role. I think also the potential influence on the acts of litigation defending a claim are unfavourable. The aspects relating to insurance have already been mentioned. It depends wholly on the market being available for that. I would share the concerns of the Law Society contribution. I should mention I sit on the Trust and Succession Law Committee, but wasn't directly involved in the contribution made. But I would share that view.
Thank you. Charlie, do you want to come in?
No.
Okay. Anyone else want to come in before we move on? No. Okay, thank you. Okay, Bill.
Thank you very much. Thanks very much, convener, and thanks to all the guests. I think they've provided some really interesting aspects of evidence, which I think is going to help the bill going forward. However, Christmas is coming, so... No, it's not, actually. But so there may be omissions to the bill which people have views on, and just to ask if there's any comments anyone would have about what they would like to have seen in part one of the bill which hasn't actually been brought forward so far. Anything that you think should be included?
I'll start with Valerie.
Thank you. I think I'd just turn back to something that we did touch on before, and that was the role of the court. I suppose just a bit of a concern that there's not any obvious way in the bill, through the bill, for a public trust to seek a variation short of going to the Court of Session, which sometimes we simply have to do. Obviously, there's a balance to be struck here. You don't want to be allowing trustees to vary at will. However, it is perhaps something that we'll never get another chance, really, to look at this. So it's taken 102 years to get from where we were to where we are now. This is the one and only, so perhaps just put a marker down there.
Thank you. Jeremy?
I'm just interested, what way do you see that happening, if I can ask that away? So, obviously, if you do, and when you do go to the Court of Session... What way would you see around that without giving the trustee too much power to do anything?
I think that's the difficulty. I think perhaps in the miscellaneous trusts that I'm concerned with, there is sometimes an opportunity to move from one specification to another. For example, if money was left for the benefit of a particular church and that church no longer existed, then that there may be a way of just moving to something that's equally acceptable, but there are boundaries to be sought. So boundaries to be set. So I agree it's difficult. However, I think it's perhaps, I'm sure legal wording can be found to create some kind of opportunity, but with some checks and balances built in to prevent the trustees just varying at will whenever they come across an issue or a difficulty.
Yeah, thank you. Ian Hood.
One was just to come back on the last issue about liability insurance, is that I don't have any as a private trustee, and I can see a situation if on the death of the beneficiary, the powers that we have as a trustee, as a trust, to decide where the money goes may be challengeable or may be challenged by relatives. I certainly wasn't really aware that was a personal liability before I'd read the trust, the bill. So obviously that's an area of concern for me now, never mind anybody who might become a trustee in the future. But the second point that I wanted to raise that about what I thought might have been in the bill was about whether or not that trusts should be registered with the court or with a court. When they're set up, as my understanding is that trusts don't have to be registered anywhere and that trusts aren't known about except from the people that hold them. I could be mistaken on that. A power of attorney can be written up by anybody but needs to be registered with a court for it to then take effect. And I do wonder whether or not trusts should at least have some kind of opportunity for public acknowledgement that of their existence as something that could be included in the bill.
OK, thank you. Jeremy?
I've got a couple
of questions. I'm going to ground the first. So, Mike, in terms of emissions.
I don't think I know enough about this to comment on usefully on emissions. It's not enough in my field.
OK, thank you. Joan?
I think my big concern is that the bill doesn't really fulfil the expectations set out in the policy memorandum. So it says how important it is that lay trustees are able to understand the legislation. And it also says that the aim of the bill is to ensure that the law of the trusts is clear and coherent. And I don't think it does that as a lay person. There are numerous different kinds of trusts. Nowhere does it say this is what this kind of trust. There's commercial trusts, there's charitable, there's private purpose trusts, public trusts. Somewhere in the legislation or the explanatory notes, there needs to be an explanation of what these different things are. And I think also that the interface with charitable trusts could be improved. And I think the discussion today has just made me feel that even more strongly. The explanatory note says this bill doesn't apply to charitable trusts, except when it does. But then it doesn't go on to say which sections apply to which kinds of trusts. And I just found, as a non-lawyer, it was very, very confusing in that respect. I should be able to read the legislation and say, well, that would apply to me, that would apply to that trust. And I don't think the legislation does that. So I think more clarity and more coherence and a better interface with charitable trust law would be very welcome.
Okay, no, thank you. And Charlie?
No, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Mary?
Just two things for me. The first is linked to that sort of lead trustee part, which I think could possibly try to resolve some mediation type situations before it gets to it. And the second is, more often than not, when we see trusts coming through, there is no reference to the underlying legislation. And I think your point, just to reinforce my thinking on that, Ian, is that for particularly individual trustees or people who are a trustee on a single trust for a family member, being directed to the underlying legislation may actually resolve a lot of issues before it comes to a head, that you're able to go back, and obviously explanatory notes etc. are more useful than perhaps the actual legislation, but it's an underlying direction where to go.
Okay, thank you. And Chris?
Picking up on Joan's point there and the clarity, but particularly on the charities piece,
We have Charities Regulation Administration Scotland Bill coming through simultaneously, and through that opportunity for OSCO to have the power to appoint interim trustees. Would the definition of trustee under this bill include interim trustees? The point that Mary made about the sine qua non trustee or a lead trustee, and also what I couldn't see was a default power of trustees to add a trustee or trustees.
Okay. Thank you. And Madeline.
Part of what Joan has said, the crossover between legislation which affects charitable trusts and the legislation in the Trust Bill, the crossover between charities and other trusts is not entirely clear, and I think that could be specified in the bill better. And there's no definition of public trust given in the bill, which I think would be helpful to provide.
Okay. No, thank you. So just before we move on, so I know Valerie has to leave at 11:30. Valerie, is there anything that you would like to put on the record before you?
No, I think that last opportunity completed my desire to come and intervene. I just hope my comments have been useful to the committee today. Yeah. Thank you.
No, they certainly have. Thank you very much. Okay. Bill. Yeah, sorry. It was Jeremy.
Yeah, thank you. Just a couple of quick questions. Really following on from Chris's comment there, I have the privilege of sitting on the other committee, which is looking at the charity bill as well. So you've mentioned that one area. Is there anything else that you think needs to be clarified between the two bills at this stage?
Not clarified as such, but there is the aspect of the accumulation of income, which I think has probably been raised in other contributions as to why the charitable trusts ought to be are excluded, but whether that is still appropriate to exclude them, but not aware of any other misalignments.
And my second question,
sorry. Charlie, thank you very much for your evidence today.
My pleasure. Thank you all.
Thank you.
I really want to just go back to Joan. I was interested in your initial opening statement about some trusts not being covered in this bill, and you mentioned things like some of the gardens around Edinburgh. I wonder, can you just maybe give me a bit more, Matt, of why you don't think they're included?
I think I would say that as a layperson, without the definitions of what the different kinds of trusts are, and there are people here who are much more expert than me who could list them, but there seem to be half a dozen different kinds of trusts, but no indication of how you would decide if you were involved with a trust, which heading it fell under, which type of trust it was. And therefore, it's impossible for me, reading this bill, to say that the park trust that I'm involved with I thought, it must be a private purpose trust, but I don't think it is. So I don't know what it is. And my point about other gardens and so on in Edinburgh is that I know that I suspect that in the sort of late 19th century, it was a thing that people did if they could afford it. They bought up bits of land so there would be green space for their private use in the city. And I think it might be useful to explore what is the nature of that arrangement. Some of them will be trusts, I think. Some of them, I know one is a company and has been since the very beginning, at the end of the 19th century. But there might be other arrangements and they might not quite fit with this legislation. And I think if this is, as Valerie said, 102 years on, we're overhauling this legislation, then wouldn't want to have to wait another 102 years to include something that we could cover now. Does that answer your question?
Oh, I wonder, since we've got a few lawyers around this table, if they want to comment on that. Is this a concern we should have as a committee, or?
I think in some historical trusts, whether they are generally trusts or unincorporated associations, by a committee that's turned into a group of members that has a board or a governing arrangement, and lack of certainty around clarification of legal status, that's been helped
through the creation of SCIAs and many unincorporated associations. Having not had that clarity previously, they may not have had a written constitution or may have had it on an A4 bit of paper, but looking to formalise their arrangements and create some protection for them as the individuals as charity trustees to move to a SCIO, but not necessarily the same type of recognition on conversion of unincorporated association to a trust and some of these historic arrangements. It can be quite nuanced as to what you're actually dealing with.
Just
so the New Haven Park Trust that I'm thinking about was explored some time ago about becoming a SCIO or a registering, but we don't have a charitable purpose, so we don't qualify as a charity. We do provide services, but we're not a charitable trust, so that wouldn't help us.
Mike?
For what it's worth, you sound like a private purpose trust as far as I read this stuff.
Thank you for that free legal advice.
But let me roll back from that being too definitive because, as I said at the start, trust law as such is not my primary stuff. I just come across it in a number of other conditions. There are a whole variety of odd arrangements out there in the country, one way or the next. Was once asked to opine upon a very peculiar arrangement by which a piece of ground was sort of owned by the people who owned the adjacent fews, but it wasn't at all obvious what it was, and since a professor at Dundee University had been involved, I hesitated to dig too deep. The problem with trying to categorise them is that you will end up with fuzzy edges at the edges of the categories, and a lot of what's in here, I think, is I haven't read it well enough to understand how the definitions of this flow through into it, and I suspect it may actually be possibly more thought through than I presently understand.
Okay, thank you. Mari?
I have to confess this isn't my area of expertise. Beyond the realms of disability, vulnerable person, disabled trusts, I'm now too far removed from it in practice to be able to safely give you a view.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Jeremy? Okay, thank you. And Bill?
Yeah, well, you're nearly there, so don't worry about it. But you were, of course, invited here because of your role in relation to trusts, even if it's not always entirely direct. However, you'll be aware that part two of this bill is on succession law. And we've heard evidence from others about this, including to do with section 72 of the bill, where the distinction people believe should be made between spouses and civil partners living with the deceased at the time of their death and spouses and civil partners who were separate from the deceased at that time and with no intention of continuing in a relationship. So that's an example of the kind of succession law debate we've been having. Is there anything in this element of the bill that you have anything that you might want to mention?
Okay. Mary?
The only thing that crossed my mind is effectively partners who don't live together, but long-term relationships. So people who are in relationships for 10, 20 years plus, but for whatever reason choose not to live together, aren't covered, and there's no protections there for either of those people necessarily. I know it's quite an unconventional, but actually I'm aware of a life situation where someone has passed away, relationship for over 20 years, and they don't live together and are not married. So,
right.
A bit unusual, but...
No, it has been mentioned before. Thank you for that, yeah.
Thank you. And Mike?
It's a typical example of the inevitable fuzzy edges of trying to do these things. I incline to the view that if you make the rules clear, people can work around them. People don't always work around them, but it's probably at least as good a legislative solution as leaving a bit of, well, maybe they'd moved out, how long have they moved out for, how do you weigh all that up? Pardon me. And you folks' choice, I think, as to how you play this in terms of the legislation, but there is a merit in being trying to be clear about it and not make too many allowances for the cases in between times because, let's face it, people can always do their will to get around most of these things.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chris?
I think it's a bit like the subjective test of incapacity. Can there be a subjective test of was there a prospective reconciliation as a genuine couple at the point of death, whether or not the couple cohabited? It's difficult. I've only ever had one case like this where an individual passed away and had actually filed for divorce but had not proceeded to complete it prior to death. I recognise it as an area that needs address, but how to build in the definition of separation is not straightforward.
Okay, well, thank you. Joan?
I don't
have anything. Okay, thank you. Madeline?
This is really not my area of professional expertise at all, but the proposals seem to be fairly sensible and in line with public expectation, although I think it is very subjective.
Okay, thank you. And Ian?
I have no comment on this. Sorry.
Okay, thank you. Okay. So just before we do close the session, is there anything that anyone would like to highlight that they possibly haven't had a chance to do so thus far? No, so nothing from Mike. Let's see, Joan. Okay, Mary. Chris.
It was just one point which was on the agenda, which we haven't got to, which is the protector's power and relating to domicile, and just to make the point that I couldn't understand the justification for the protector's ability to move the domicile of a Scots Trust.
Okay, thank you. And Madeline?
No, nothing further.
Thank you. And Ian?
No, nothing further. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. With that, I would like to also kind of thank everyone for the contribution today, also written submissions as well as coming to the committee. And certainly also now that today is over, I mean, if there is anything that you do think about over the course of the next few days or so that you think would be useful to contact the committee on, please do so. We are looking for also for anything that's going to help in terms of the process of the bill going through the parliamentary process. So, once well, thank you very much once again for all your helpful evidence, and the committee may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from today's meeting. So, with that, I will suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave the room and also blue jeans. Thank you very much.